We'll continue our discussion on the first form of market, that is perfect competition. So if you remember in the last session, we are discussing about the this type of market form, that is perfect competition, and this is one type of extreme edge compared to the monopoly. So in the last class, we discussed about the different characteristic features of perfect competition and how it makes it a perfect competitive market structure. Then we talked about the demand and revenue of a firm, competitive firm, and demand and revenue for the industry. Then you talked about the profit maximizing condition, that is two condition, one is necessary condition and second one is sufficient condition. Then taking these two profit maximizing condition, we analyze the short run equilibrium in different situation like supernormal profit, normal profit and supernormal losses. And then we talked about the the subnormal profit, what generally the firm gets when they are getting into the shutdown operation. We check the shutdown condition, in which case generally the firm stops the production, get out of the market. And when if you look at in a typical market, the manager has to take two decision, either whether to produce or whether to shut down. So we check the, in that context, we check the shutdown condition. So in today's session, we'll start our discussion with the supply, market supply and firm supply analysis in the short run. Then we'll discuss the long run profit maximization. Then we'll talk about the long run supply analysis. Then we'll see how, what is the imposition of tax, generally what is the effect of imposition of tax in the theory of typically in the perfect competitive market. And then we'll see whether there is a relevance of this perfect competitive market structure in the real world. So to start with the short run market supply, if you remember, we just stopped our discussion on the in the last session on the shutdown condition. And what is a shutdown condition? If the price goes below the minimum of ABC, generally the firm shut down the operation. So that is the starting point to analyze the short run supply function in case of a perfect competitive market structure. The perfectly competitive firm produces above the minimum point of ABC, because any level of output below the minimum point of ABC, it brings there is no profit or no loss. Maybe it's not loss, apart from profit, it's not loss, even they're not able to cover the variable cost also, and discontinues the production if price falls short of minimum of ABC. So from this shutdown condition, there are two condition emerge. One, condition one, if price is less than minimum of ABC, then shutdown. Condition two, if price is greater than or equal to minimum of ABC, then choose any output that would maximize the profit. One is, the first case is very clear, if it is less than minimum of ABC, then shutdown. Second one, if it is greater than or equal to minimum ABC, then the firm should go for production. But there again, he has to take a call, or the manager has to take a call, that what is the output level that would maximize the profit. And to get that level of output, again the firm has to go to the profit maximizing condition, taking both the first order and second order, or the so called necessary and sufficient condition to profit maximization. So short run supply curve for any individual firm can be derived from these two condition, that is condition one, shutdown, condition two, produce the profit maximizing level of output. So if price is less than minimum of ABC, firm would not supply, output would be equal to zero. So any level of price which is less than minimum of ABC, firm would not supply. So obviously if it is shutdown, then output would be equal to zero. For such price, supply curve will coincide with the vertical axis, because at this price, if the output is zero, the supply curve will coincide with the vertical axis. Whereas for any price above minimum of average variable cost, the firm would choose an output level that would satisfy the condition of profit maximization. So supply curve of the firm would be identical to the short run marginal cost curve above the minimum point of average variable cost. And industry supply curve can be obtained by horizontal summation of the supply curve for all the firms in the industry. So the point here to note that any point in the minimum below the any price point below the minimum point of ABC, there is a shutdown. So we can start at the starting point for the supply, because if the price is at that level, then only the output will be produced and the supply will be given to the market. So that is the starting point, and that's why if you look at where ABC is minimum, maybe ABC is minimum at when it's actually the marginal cost curve cuts the ABC at its minimum point. That is the reason we consider the marginal cost of the farm in the short run is the supply curve, not the entire marginal cost curve, rather the that segment of the marginal cost curve which lies above the minimum point of average variable cost, that serves as the short run supply curve in the perfect competitive market. That is for the farm. And if you do a horizontal summation of all supply curve, all individual supply curve for all competitive farm, then we reach to the market supply curve. Let's see graphically how we reach to the market supply curve. This is our short run average cost curve. This is our average variable cost, short run average variable cost, and its minimum point marginal cost curve will intersect. So this is the corresponding to this is P star, this is our equilibrium price, that is P star. So now how to identify the supply curve? So P star is the price that is decided on the basis of the market price. Any price if it is goes below this P star to double P star, any price if it is goes below that, then the market or the sellers, they will not supply in the market. And that is the reason if you look at this is the starting point of the supply curve, and the segment marginal cost segment which is lies above the minimum point of the average variable cost, that becomes the supply curve for the farm. So the short run supply curve is the that segment of the marginal cost curve which lies above the minimum point of average variable cost, because if you look at that is the starting point of the supply. If price goes below that, generally the supplier, they are not supplying the product into the market. Now we'll just take a numerical example to understand. Typically when we take it in the real life case, when we have a cost function given, when we have a demand function given, how to identify what is the shutdown condition, or how to find out the price below which the farm generally not supplying any product to the market. So we'll take the market demand curve, that is D, that is equal to 25 minus 0.5 P, and we'll take the supply, that is 10 plus 1.0 P. So if we now, and the cost function will take as 25 minus 2Q plus 4Q square. Now we need to find out, should the farm produce in the short run and if they are producing in the short run, how much quantity they should produce. Okay. Now from the demand and supply function, we will try to find out what is the equilibrium price or what is the market clearing price where the seller and buyer, they will sell and buy whatever they would like to interested. So the demand curve is 25 minus 0.5 P, and the supply curve is 10 plus 1.0 P. So this is typically the demand is equal to supply. If you solve this, then we will get P is equal to 10 and Q is equal to 20. So P is equal to 10 is the equilibrium price and Q is equal to 20 is the equilibrium quantity, or we can call it market clearing price and market clearing quantity. Now, what is the next task we have to do in order to find out the minimum point, the shutdown point? We need to find out the profit maximizing level of output. And how to find the profit maximizing level of output? That is again through the profit maximizing condition, that is marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost, and the slope of the MC should be greater than the slope of the marginal revenue curve. So, in the long run, if you remember, what is the equilibrium condition? The long run, before going to the long run equilibrium condition is where the long run average cost curve should be equal to the P, which is equal to MC. Taking the same thing in the short run, because if you look at MC is equal to MR, MR is also equal to P in case of the perfect competitive market structure. So, if it is MR is equal to MC, we can also reframe that as MC is equal to P, because MR and P is equal in case of a perfect competitive market structure. So, for profit maximization, we know that marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost, and which is also equal to P. So, now what is marginal cost? Marginal cost is minus 2 plus 8Q, that is how we get this MC? We get this MC by taking the derivative of the total cost with respect to Q. So, minus 2 plus 8Q. Now, this minus 2 plus 8Q has to be equal to the price, H price is equal to marginal cost. Now, to solve it for Q, it will come 1 by 8 P plus 2. Now, we know that firm will produce till the time P is greater than equal to average variable cost, or we can say average revenue is greater than equal to average variable cost, as in case of perfect competitive market structure, P is equal to average revenue. So, to find that this P is equal to average revenue, this is how we say that, okay, if at any point of time if AR is greater than equal to ABC or P is greater than equal to ABC, firm will continue the production. Now, we will find the total variable cost. Total variable cost is minus 2Q plus 4Q square, and through this we can find out the average variable cost, and average variable cost is minus 2 plus 4Q. So, as we know that ABC is a linear function, and as it is a linear function, it has no minimum. So, the firm would produce the quantity which is Q is equal to 1 by 8, that is P plus 2. So, that is equal to, if you simplify this again, 1.8, P is equal to 10, as you have decided the equilibrium price, that is 10 plus 2. So, this comes to as 1.5 units. Okay. So, Q is 1.5 units. Now, what is total revenue? Total revenue is P multiplied by Q. So, P multiplied by H, P is equal to 10, Q is multiplied by, Q is 1.5. So, 10 multiplied by 1.5, it comes to 15. So, Q is equal to 1.5, total revenue is equal to 15. Similarly, what is the total cost? Total cost, we have to put the value of Q in the total cost, and there we get the total cost is equal to 31. Now, what is the profit here? Profit should be ideally total revenue minus total cost, and total revenue minus total cost, if it comes, total revenue is 15 and total cost is 31, which is minus 16. So, this cannot be called as profit, rather this is loss. So, in this case, in this cost function, if they are operating at a profit maximizing level, that is P is equal to MC, they are not getting the profit, rather than that they are incurring loss. So, now we know that the loss is equal to minus 16, or maybe we can say loss is equal to 16. Now, what is our fixed cost? So, if you remember your cost function is 25 minus 2Q plus 4q square. So here this part is average variable cost, this part is variable cost, and this part is fixed cost. So whatever the loss that is less than the fixed cost, that is equal to 16. So the firm, what is the decision for the firm? Now firm would produce 1.5 unit and incur a loss of 16. But the natural question comes here, that why the firm should produce when they are getting a loss of 16 rupees. Because if you remember the shutdown condition what we discussed, till the time they are covering the variable cost, they should produce, because it is still profitable for them that they are not incurring fixed cost by shutting down the operation. Point one. Point two is, here if you look at, the fixed cost is more than the loss. So if they are incurring it, if they are producing, at least they are paying less, or they are incurring less loss. But if they are thus shutting down, they have to pay 25 rupees, which is equal to the fixed cost. And point two is that, since this is a short run situation, the possibility is that even if they are incurring loss now, at least if they are continuing the production, if they are continuing the operation, at least when it goes to the long run scenario, at least they will incur a normal profit, or they will incur a supernormal profit. And short run, since the time period is short, always the producer would like to continue the production even if they are incurring the loss, with the aspiration, with the hope that they are going to at least get the profit, at least in the long run. So now next we'll move to the long run equilibrium, and how the short run is different from long run, because long run is the situation where all the inputs are variable and the output can be increased by changing all the inputs. There is no fixed cost in the long run. So in the long run, the perfect competitive firm only earn the normal profit. There is no case of loss, there is no case of supernormal profit. All the firms, they earn normal profit in case of a perfect competitive firm. This is due to unrestricted entry into and exit of firms from the industry in the long run. So if you remember, one of the characteristic what we discuss in the case of characteristic perfect competitive economy is the free entry and free exit. And this is the main source of this is the main point that why the perfect competitive firm just unlock the normal profit. Two extreme possibility generally it may happens. We can discuss two extreme possibility, and then from there we can lead to the fact that why the firm only they earn the normal profit in the case of the long run. So one, firms earning supernormal profit, and second, firms incur losses in the short run. Even in the first case, the firm is earning supernormal profit in the long run. Taking this as a situation, let's see how generally the firms end in a situation where they just get the normal profit. Assuming that if some of the firm, they are just earning the supernormal profit in the short run. Now, what will the outcome or what will be the consequence? Supernormal profit, some of the existing firms, they are making profit in the supernormal profit in the market. There is free entry, so that will be the incentive for the few more firms to go and operate in the market, because it's profitable market, and few of the firms they are getting profit over here. New firms enter into the market, there is no restriction on entry. Supply increases, because they also go and produce the same product, because this is the market where the uniform product or the identical product gets produced. With the entry of new firm, supply is of the market increases. We are assuming there is no change in the demand, because when the firms get profit, that may not profitable for the buyers. So if buyers, if it is not profitable, maybe they are not demanding more in the market. Existing firm earns supernormal profit, which attracts the new firms to enter into the market. New firm enter into the market, no change in the demand, supply increases, this lower the market prices, because supply is more and demand is less. The process of adjustment continue till the time price equal to the long run average cost, that is average revenue is equal to average cost, which is again equal to the marginal revenue and marginal cost. So in this case, it's the case of the normal profit where average revenue is equal to the average cost. So the entry of new firm will continue to come till the time at least all the firms they are not getting the normal profit in the market. So if you look at the supernormal profit of the existing firm are squeezed until all the firms in the industry earn the normal profit. Then we will take the second situation where some of the firm or maybe existing firms, some of the existing firms they are getting or they are incurring loss. Now what would be the outcome since this is long run and they are already incurring loss from the short run onwards. This would force few of the producer or few of the sellers to leave the industry in the long run because they may not able to sustain loss for the long period of time. Their exit from the industry causes a reduction in the supply of the product and as a result equilibrium price in the industry increases. So now there is a decrease in the supply, demand remains constant, there is an increase in the equilibrium price of the industry. The process of adjustment again continue to the point where the marginal firm no longer earn losses, or we can say till the time price line is tangent to the average cost. So the process of adjustment continue to the point where the managerial firm, where the marginal firm no longer earn losses and till the price line tangent to the average cost. And if the price line is tangent to the average cost, that is how we get the normal profit. Equilibrium occurs at a point where price is tangent to the long run average cost and all the firms make normal profit in the long run. So equilibrium occurs at a point where price is tangent to the long run average cost curve and all the firms they just earn the normal profit. So whether you take the case of supernormal profit, whether you take the case of the supernormal loss, this is not going to continue in the long run, at least in the perfect competitive market structure, which has a significant feature as free entry and free exit. And because of that, at the end of the day, if you will find all perfectly competitive firm, they are just getting the normal profit. Even if they are getting a supernormal profit or the incurring loss, generally that in a time period, generally they again come back to a situation where all the firms they are just getting the normal profit. So the condition from the profit maximizing behavior of the firm from the long run emerges from here, that is P is equal to marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue, which is equal to the long run average cost curve. So we'll just see the graphical representation that how graphically we can reach to a long run equilibrium. This is P, which is also equal to average revenue and marginal revenue. Here we take the quantity where we take the average revenue, marginal revenue and price, and this is the long run average cost curve, this is the short run average cost curve, this is the short run marginal cost curve, and this is the equilibrium point and this is the equilibrium level of output. So what is the profit maximizing condition in case of long run? That is long run average cost curve is equal to the short run average cost curve equal to the short run marginal cost curve equal to the marginal equal to the marginal revenue and equal to the average revenue. So the equality of long run average cost curve, short run average cost curve, short run marginal cost curve, marginal revenue and average revenue, that leads to the long run equilibrium, long run profit maximization. Then we'll see the supply curve in case of the long run market supply and long run individual firm supply in case of three different type of industry, that is constant cost industry, increasing cost industry and decreasing cost industry. So if you remember, the in case of short run, the market supply is horizontal summation of the individual firm supply curve. And how we get the individual firm supply curve? Individual firm supply curve is that segment of the marginal cost curve which lies above the average variable cost. But that cannot be done in case of the long run, because in the long run, at least we are not checking the shutdown condition. It's actually exit from the market. So in the long run, we'll see that whenever there is a changes in the price, whenever there is a changes in the factor of production, it's not only due to change in the price, also due to the change in the factor of production, the increase or decrease in the prices of the factor, that also lead to the change in the supply. So that we'll analyze through the three different industry, that is constant cost industry, increasing cost industry and decreasing cost industry. To start with, we will first analyze the constant cost industry. Constant cost industry is an industry in which cost of production remain constant as output in the industry expand. Means the scale of output is increasing at the constant cost of production, there is no increased cost of production. Now, we know that whenever there is a supernormal profit, new firms enter into the market. What will happen to the supply of the product as new firms enter into the industry? Obviously, supply will increase because new firm, they have entered into the industry. What happens to the price of the product? Price is decreases because given the demand, then supply is more and demand is constant, supply has increased. So now supply is more than demand and that leads to decrease in the price. So price goes back to where it was before the demand change, but there is no more output being produced by more firm. So the price goes back where it was before the demand changes, but there is no more output is being produced by more firms, because they know that if they are increasing the supply, that leads to decrease in the market price and it is no more profitable for the existing firm at least. Note that if price didn't drop enough, there would be still the positive economic profit and firm would continue to enter the industry. So if price is not decreasing significantly, still there will be some amount of the economic profit and which will again act as an incentive for the firm to enter into the industry. The firms would continue to enter in the industry, supply would keep increasing and the price would drop some more, because since there is a new firm still entering, still supply will increase and price will again decrease more. The second one is, if the price dropped too much, it would not cover cost per unit, there would be losses. So at least they are not getting only the supernormal profit, also they are not getting the normal profit, rather they are incurring loss. Firm would leave the industry, supply would fall and the price would come back just covering the cost of, price would come back up just covering cost per unit. So either if it is just dropping a bit, again new firm will continue to come because still there is some amount of profit. If it is drops too much, the existing firm, they incur loss, and when they are not covering up their cost per unit, they prefer to exit the market, which will reduce the supply and the price would come back off just covering the cost per unit. So what has happened as a result of increase in the demand in the constant cost industry? We now have the same price we had before, but we now have more output because you have more firms in the industry. So in a constant cost industry, firm will produce as much or as little as the economic demands at a price which is just enough to cover the cost per unit. They will not produce more than that because it is a constant cost industry. Firm will produce only whatever is the requirement on the basis of the demand at a price which is just enough to cover the cost per unit. It means the long run supply curve in a constant cost industry is horizontal, because price is fixed and the supply, they increase on the basis of the demand. Whenever there is an increase in the demand, they just cover up that at the typical price. Now we'll see what is the how is the graphical representation of the long run supply curve in case of constant cost industry. So this is our demand curve, this is the demand curve, this is S1, this is S0. So this is T0, this is S0. So this is our P0, and at the same price we'll continue to supply more. So that's why this is our long run supply curve, and this is the price, that is P1. This is one equilibrium point, this is another equilibrium point. So the long run supply curve is constant because they are not producing more, they are just increasing the supply just on the basis of the demand that it comes from the consumer. So this is the long run supply curve in case of constant cost industry, which is just a straight line and it's parallel to the x-axis. Then we'll take this case in case of the increasing cost industry and decreasing cost industry. Now what is a increasing cost industry? Increasing cost industry is when they increase the scale of output, the cost of production also increases. So in case of increasing cost industry, factor prices rise as the new firms enter into the market and existing firm expand the capacity. Because new firms enter into the market, they require input, they require factors, and also the existing firm, they expand their capacity, they also need the factor. And as well, since the demand is increasing, the factor price also increasing given the supply at that same level. So if the inputs are specialized, factor prices are likely to rise when the increase in the industry wide demand for inputs to products increases. So demand remain, if demand is the new firms enter into the market, existing firm expand the production capacity, that leads to increase in the industry wide demand for inputs. And if the inputs are specialized, again the factor prices are likely to increase. The rise in the factor cost or the increase in the factor cost would force the cost for each firm in the industry and increase the price at which firms earn the zero profit. So when there is an increase in the factor cost, that also lead to increase in the cost of the each firm, because now they are spending more on the incurring the expenses of the factors and the inputs, and increase the price, because if input cost is more, obviously the market price has to be more, because that is if the price is not covering the input cost, the firm will prefer to leave the market if they are not getting the profit. Since it's a long run, at least they should get the normal profit. So increase in the factor price would force the cost of the firms to increasing, and also the increase in the price, because at least they feel that the unit cost should at least earn, which the firms earn zero profit. Therefore, in case of increasing cost industry, the long run supply curve is upward sloping, because increase in the new firms enter into the market, existing firm expand the size, demand for input increases, and sometimes there is also demand for specialized input, that leads to increase in the cost of production for the firms, that leads to increase in the market price. And that is the reason in case of increasing cost industry, we get a upward sloping supply curve. And that will check graphically that how we get a upward sloping curve in case of increasing cost industry. So this is increasing cost industry. We are finding out the long run supply curve. So we have D0, we have D1, then we have S0, and then we have S1. So this is E0, this is E1, and corresponding to this we have P0, we have P1, and if you join this 2.E0 to E1, we get a long run supply curve. So it is upward sloping in case of increasing cost industry. And why it is upward sloping? Because the factor price increases, which leads to the increase in the cost of production for the firm, and also which leads to the increase in the market price, and that force the firms to charge a higher price, because they have to at least cover up the unit cost what they are incurring to produce the product. Now we'll check the decreasing cost industry. So in case of decreasing cost industry, if input price declines when the industry output expand, individual firms marginal cost curve shift down and the long run supply curve is downward sloping. So since in case of decreasing cost industry, when the scale of operation increases, it increases with a decreasing cost of production. So that has to give a reason that if because of the decrease in the input price. So if input price declines when the industry output expands, individual firms marginal cost curve shift down because the per unit cost decreases and the long run supply curve is downward sloping. So it's a case of decreasing cost industry where the scale of operation increases, cost of production decreases because of less input price, which leads to decrease in the marginal cost shift downs, and that lead to decrease in the long run supply curve in case of a perfectly competitive market structure, typically in case of decreasing cost industry. So input price may decline to the zero profit condition when output increases, and when new entrants make it more cost effective for other firms to provide services to all firms in the market. So input price may decline to the zero profit condition when output increases, and when new entrants make it more cost effective for the other firms services for the all firms in the market. So we'll see the graphical representation of the decreasing cost industry. So this is long run supply in case of decreasing cost industry, D0, then we have D1, S0, we have S1. So we have E0, we have E1. So this is the first equilibrium, this is the second equilibrium, and if you do this, then this is our long run supply curve. Because this is a decreasing cost industry, expansion is at a decreasing cost per unit, and that is the reason we get a downward sloping long run supply curve in case of the decreasing cost industry. So in case of constant cost industry, the long run supply curve is a straight line, horizontal. In case of increasing cost industry, the long run supply curve is upward sloping because the cost of production increases when the scale of operations expand or when new firms enter into the market. And in case of decreasing cost industry, the long run supply curve is downward sloping because the cost of production decreases when the firm, or maybe the scale of operation increases at a decreasing cost per unit of production. Then we'll see that what is the effect of tax, or how the buyers and sellers, they bone the tax, imposition of the tax, or the bone the burden of the tax in case of a perfect competitive market structure. So we'll talk about typically three type of tax. One, imposition of a lump sum tax. Second, imposition of a profit tax, and finally the imposition of a specific sales tax. So if you look at the lump sum tax, it's the effect of lump sum tax is like a effect of the fixed cost, because the effect is on the fixed cost. And if you look at the in the short run, if there is a change in the fixed cost, it is not going to change the it is not going to change the equilibrium position, because till the time it is not affecting the marginal cost, it is not going to change the equilibrium position. And in case of, similarly in case of profit tax, again it's a, the effect is like a fixed cost, but in the long run the possibility is that that supply will shift. But in case of specific sale tax, the imposition of tax is dealt through the elasticity of supply, and that talks about that how much is the sensitiveness of the supplier with respect to change in the price. So we'll start our explanation for the imposition of the tax from the lump sum tax. And lump sum tax is like, it's one time lump sum, so it's the effect is like a fixed cost. At least in the short term there is no effect, but when it comes to long run, maybe there is some effect, because there may be a decrease in the output. Okay. So this is the average revenue, that is marginal revenue. Here we get the short run total cost curve, and this is the average fixed cost. Then there is an increase in the average fixed cost after the imposition of the tax, that's why this is average fixed cost, change in that average fixed cost. And with the change in the average fixed cost, the short term average cost curve is increasing, that is SCTC 1, and marginal cost generally intersect the average variable cost and average cost at its minimum. So if you look at, in case of lump sum tax, only there is an increase in the fixed cost, and that shift the average total cost curve. There is a change in the average total cost curve. Otherwise there is no much effect, at least in the short run, but in the long run, at least to the some level of output, it is going to influence. But if you look at, if it is short run, someone is just earning the normal profit, then in the long run he has to incur loss because of the lump sum tax. But in the short run, if someone is getting supernormal profit, at least after imposition of tax, he will get only the normal profit, or there is some reduction in the amount of profit, but at least he is not incurring loss. So in this situation, at least they are getting affected through the lump sum tax, because they are moving from one possibility to another possibility, that is either from supernormal profit to normal profit or from normal profit to loss. Then we will take the effect of the profit tax. So profit tax is also somehow in the same category, that this is the effect of like a change in the fixed cost, but sometimes due to this the supply changes, at least in the long run, and it leads to increase in the price. So this is the demand curve, this is the supply curve, this is the equilibrium quantity, this is the equilibrium price. So at least in the short run it is not much of change, but when it takes to the long run, it's generally shift the supply to the up, and that leads to increase in the price and decrease in the quantity demanded. So the effect of the profit tax, if you will see, it is much felt in the long run rather than the short run, because short run it has nothing more to do, or the effect is not much. But in case of a long run, that leads to decrease in the supply, because there is an imposition of profit tax that leads to increase in the supply, which leads to increase in the price and decrease in the quantity demanded. And what is the specific effect of on farm because of this profit tax? Again the same explanation, if they are earning supernormal profit in the short run, at least it is not much, because there will be some reduction in the profit, but if they are just getting the normal profit, the possibility that they may land into incurring loss, at least in the long run, with the imposition of the profit tax. Now we'll analyze the case of specific sales tax, and this effect of the specific sales tax is more on what is the elasticity of supply. If the elasticity of supply is more, generally the firms pay less for the tax, and if it is less, then the firm has to pay more for the tax. So it's all about the elasticity of supply curve that decides that what is the effect of specific sales tax on buyers and what is the effect of specific sales tax on the seller. So if you will take different scenario and we'll see how the imposition of specific sales tax affecting the buyers and seller. So if you take a regular demand curve and the supply curve, then this is the demand curve, this is the supply curve, and when there is a imposition of tax that is shown through the change in the supply, so in this case this is the tax and this is the change in the price after imposition of tax. So if you look at here, the entire tax amount is not passed to the consumer. Entire tax amount is not passed to the consumer in the form of increase in the price. Still this much amount is paid by the seller. So if you look at here, the imposition of the specific sales tax is equally on both the side, buyers and seller, if it is a case of the regular demand and supply curve. Now suppose we'll take another example where the supply curve is elastic than the previous case, and here if you look at, this is the amount of the tax and this is the change in the price. So in this case, if you make it a comparison between the first case and the second case, if the supply, since the supply curve is more elastic, the major part of the burden of the tax is passed to the consumer in the form of increase in the price. But in case of the first case, if you look at, equally both the seller and buyer, they were paying the tax amount, but here the supply curve is elastic, so there is some leverage in the seller side to pass the burden of tax to the consumer in term of increase in the price, and that's why here it is more as compared to this, because the change in the price is more in case of the second case, and by through change in the price generally the tax is passed to the consumer, or maybe majority portion of the tax is passed to the consumer. Then we'll take a case where the supply curve is perfectly elastic. Okay, and this is the demand curve. Here we can take the maybe demand and supply, and here the price. So in this case, if you look at, this is the tax amount, and the entire tax is passed to the consumer in the form of increase in the price, because here the supply curve is perfectly elastic. Any small change in the price will lead to greater change in the supply, and that is the reason if you look at the entire tax burden is passed to the consumer. So more elastic is the market supply, higher is the proportion of specific tax that can be passed to the consumer. So more elastic is the supply, higher the burden to the consumer. So in case of lump sum tax and fixed tax, in case of lump sum tax and profit tax, the effect is like a fixed cost of production, and if you look at, it's not getting much of effect in case of short term, but in case of long run, the possibility is that they may incur loss if they're just getting the normal profit. And in case of specific sales tax, it's always the elasticity of supply that decides that what is the effect of this imposition of tax on the sellers. If supply is more elastic, burden is less. If supply is less elastic, the burden is more. Then we'll look at some of this efficiency criterion in perfectly competitive market. So if you remember, in the initial class we talked about the allocative efficiency and productive efficiency. So we'll check in the first case what is the resource allocative efficiency in case of a perfectly competitive market. Any firm they produce at the marginal revenue which is equal to the marginal cost, and since marginal revenue is equal to P for competitive firm, then P is also equal to marginal cost. Now what is the meaning? Meaning here is the marginal benefit, that is through demand, and marginal cost, that is supplier using the society resources. So society marginal value of resources is equal to the opportunity cost of using resources, and that is how we use the allocative efficiency, or that is how the allocative efficiency gets satisfied in case of a perfectly competitive market. And when we again explain this through the consumer surplus and producer surplus, if you look at the graph over here, the consumer surplus is, if you remember the at least the definition, the consumer surplus is one where any price above the market price, if the consumer is ready to pay more and if they are paying less, generally they get some amount of the consumer surplus. So consumer surplus area in specific graph, if you look at ABPP is the consumer surplus area because that is the above the market price, and supplier surplus is, that is CBPE, so that is again C, P and B, and competitive equilibrium maximize the market surplus. Now the question is, what about Q1, what about the level of output? So the second case is productive efficiency. Here the firm produces at the minimum of average total cost in the long run, and a firm economizing on resource use, and if not, competing firm would undercut its price and capture the extra profit. So since they are economizing on the resource use, that again satisfies the productive efficiency. Then we will see what is the application of perfect competitive market in the real world, and we will take the typical example of stock market. As I said, the stock market, share market somehow share at least some of the feature of the perfect competitive market. So if you are taking the example of stock market, whether this is a perfect competitive market in the real world, let's analyze what are the similarity and what are the dissimilarity. The price of stock usually determined by the market forces of demand and supply of stock, which goes with the perfect competitive market structure. Individual buyers and sellers have very little impact on price as they are the price taker. Again, the same situation what we generally face in case of a perfect competitive market structure. Perfect mobility of resources, and here also the resources are mobile as stock is bought and sold frequently. And information about the price and quantity are readily available. So, there is full information and perfect information to all the people, those who are in the stock market, buyers and seller. So, price decided by the market demand and market supply, first feature. Individual buyer seller has less impact, second feature. Perfect mobility of the resources, third feature. And full information about the product price, fourth feature. All these four features get matched, or it comes from the characteristic of a perfect competitive market structure. Now, we need to see that whether there is imperfection, but before that, we will see that whether like in before a couple of minutes we are talking about the efficiency of the, or whether the productive efficiency and allocative efficiency get satisfied in the perfect competitive market structure or not. So, to take that as a cue, and similar, the same thing happens in case of stock market, that fund flows into the stock and resources flow into the use, and in which the rate of return. So, stock price provides a significant signal for the efficient allocation of investment in the economy. So, till the time all these features are matching with the perfect competitive market structure. But still there are some imperfection, and that is why we cannot say that there in a rigid form there is the perfect competitive market structure, but somehow there is a close resemblance of this type of market structure with the perfect competitive market structure. Now, what is the imperfection over here? Imperfection occurs here also, though stock market is very close to perfect competition. For example, sale of huge amount of stock by a large corporation will affect the price of stock, which goes against the characteristic of perfect competitive market structure, that one seller or one buyer cannot influence the price of the product. So, to summarize, we can say that perfect competitive market, stock market closely come to the perfect competitive market, but still it is, there are some imperfection occurs. So in the next class, again we'll take one more example, like whether credit card industry comes in the category of perfect competitive market structure or not, and then we'll start our discussion on the monopoly. So to summarize whatever we discussed today is, we talked about the market supply in the short run, which is the segment of MC which lies above the average variable cost. We talk about the long run equilibrium. We discuss about the long run supply curve in case of increasing cost industry, constant cost industry, decreasing cost industry. And we talked about the imposition of tax, and we talked about the allocative efficiency and productive efficiency, whether that is getting satisfied in case of a perfect competitive market structure or not. So, we will carry forward our discussion of a perfect competitive market structure, application to real world and monopoly in the next session.